Really quick, if you haven't been here, we're in a message series that is, I'm calling The Gospel According to Disney. We're just looking at Disney films and whether or not the messages that they convey to us and to our kids, which are very impressionable, whether or not they are true and whether they line up with Scripture. Last week, I talked about Pinocchio and the difference between our conscience and the Holy Spirit. Today, I want to talk about Beauty and the Beast and the message that is conveyed through that movie. But before I do, let me direct your attention up here to the screen. Check this out.
Once upon a time, in a faraway land, a young prince lived in a shining castle. Although he had everything his heart desired, the prince was spoiled, selfish, and unkind. But then, one winter's night, an old beggar woman came to the castle and offered him a single rose in return for shelter from the bitter cold. Repulsed by her haggard appearance, the prince sneered at the gift and turned the old woman away. But she warned him not to be deceived by appearances, for beauty is found within. And when he dismissed her again, the old woman's ugliness melted away to reveal a beautiful enchantress. The prince tried to apologize, but it was too late, for she had seen that there was no love in his heart. And as punishment, she transformed him into a hideous beast and placed a powerful spell on the castle and all who lived there. Ashamed of his monstrous form, the beast concealed himself inside his castle with a magic mirror as his only window to the outside world. The rose she had offered was truly an enchanted rose which would bloom until his 21st year. If he could learn to love another and earn her love in return by the time the last petal fell, then the spell would be broken. If not, he would be doomed to remain a beast for all time. As the years passed, he fell into despair and lost all hope. For who could ever learn to love a beast?
Well, it serves him right. I was kidding. Yeah, even after this prince was warned or told by this old beggar that beauty's found within and that he should not be deceived by appearances, he ignores her. And he goes ahead and does it anyway, and of course he suffers the consequences for his behavior. Now, for those of you who have not seen the movie, essentially the rest of the film goes on to show how this young lady named Belle, she finds herself captive in the Beast's castle, where they eventually strike up this really unusual or unlikely friendship. And the whole time, the Beast and his little friends are hoping to convince Belle to look past the Beast's outward appearance. And in the end, of course, she does. She comes to value the inward characteristics of the Beast, and she falls in love with him despite his outward appearance. And it's this really beautiful story that teaches a biblical principle that I want to talk to us about this morning, which is that we should be very, very careful not to accept or reject people based on their outward appearance, based on what they look like. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16 says this. This is the Apostle Paul. He says, "From now on, we should regard no one according to the flesh." That's a very theological way of putting it. Here's something that's a little more layman's terms. This is 2 Corinthians 5:16 in the Message version, where it says, "We don't evaluate people by what they have or how they look." And this is also repeated again in Colossians chapter 3, verse 11. Words like Jewish and non-Jewish, you can say black or white or Mexican or Asian, whatever, religious and irreligious, insider, outsider, uncivilized, unsophisticated, slave and free mean nothing. From now on, he says, everyone is defined by Christ. Everyone is included in Christ. This is a wonderful message from the scriptures here that I don't believe there's any more relevant message for America today than this one. Because every single one of us have a conscious or unconscious bias about certain people groups. And we see this all the time. In fact, it's been on the news a lot recently. You can't turn on the TV without seeing how this is played out across the world. Racial division and all sorts of stuff. Now, I'm not going to bother you with the science of all of it, but it's called implicit bias. Now, here, let me read you the definition from perception.org. Thoughts and feelings are implicit if we're unaware of them or we're mistaken about their nature. We have a bias when, rather than being neutral, we have a preference for or aversion to a person or a group of people. Thus, we use the term implicit bias to describe when we have attributes towards people or associate stereotypes with them without our conscious knowledge. Now, I want to show you a few pictures, and I want you to, as I show them, I want you to take note of how you feel when you see these pictures. Now, I want you to know up front that I'm not trying to talk about the rightness or wrongness of any particular issue that is represented in these photos. That is not my point. I simply want you to consider how you feel when you see some of these images here. So, for example, this first one. This is a few women wearing what is called a burqa, right? Where it's just their eyes and everything else is covered. Sometimes even their eyes are covered, depending on where they live. But imagine you saw some women walking down Main Street wearing that. How would you feel? Be honest with yourself. Or how about this? When you're driving down toward Portland, and maybe, yeah, I was there yesterday, and you see these tents all over the place, lining the side of the road. What does that make you feel like? Particularly when you see the trash strewn about. You feel something. Or think of when you're walking to dinner on the streets of Portland and you see a homeless person and you see how bad it's gotten there. They're just all over the streets. You have to practically walk around them, otherwise you'd have to step over them. How does it make you feel? How do homeless people make you feel? Do you feel frustrated, disgusted? How about this? Because we were divided politically. You're persuaded one way or another. Some of you know who Miss Ocasio-Cortez is. You feel a certain way when you see her. Or how about this other person? Right. You feel a certain way when you see the face of our president. Well, he's not my president. Okay, well, that's not my point. I'm just saying one way or the other, you feel a certain way when you see folks like this. Here's just a few more, a couple more. Here's a snapshot of some folks marching down the street who believe that their rights are being violated in some way. And the next photo is for another people group who feels similarly, as though their human rights are being violated. Now, again, I'm not talking about who's right or wrong or what side of the fence you are in regard to any of these issues. I'm just simply saying, I want you to examine how you feel, because if you're anything like me, there are certain feelings and emotions that are stirred up when you see stuff. And if you didn't feel anything, then it's probably because I didn't show up here on the screen the particular people group that you might find yourself frustrated or disgusted by. And I think it's important for us to be honest with ourselves, examine our hearts, and if there is a way in which we are biased against someone, to really take a look at that. Because in the same way that the old woman, that beggar in Beauty and the Beast, warned that young prince about judging people by their outward appearance, you and I are also warned about doing the same thing. We shouldn't be doing that as Christians. As we know, unchecked biases can lead to very, very deadly results that are reflected in news stories like this one, atrocities, tragedies like this one, where, listen, I don't know if you know this, but I'm Mexican, if you haven't noticed, okay? And this gentleman was targeting Mexican folks. Now, sometimes I forget that I'm Mexican, but if I was in Walmart, my skin color would have had me in the sights of this deranged man. And that's what happens when, again, unchecked biases lead to destructive consequences, not just these ones, but horrific atrocities even that we've seen in the not-so-distant past. That's what happens. It's important for us to examine our hearts. So the Bible says, the Lord doesn't see the things the way that you and I do. He says, people judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. That's the Old Testament, but Jesus reflected the same thing. He said, stop judging based on the superficial. First, you must embrace the standards of mercy and truth. He's saying you must embrace the standards of mercy and truth. Well, what is that? What is truth? We live in this day and age where what's true for you may not be true for me. Truth is relative. And it's important for us to define what these standards of truth and mercy and justice are, because most everyone thinks that they're standing on the right side of justice. If you think of issues like abortion, both sides, that they think that they're upholding and defending justice for someone, whether it be the woman or the unborn child. So what is justice? I'm going to show you just a couple of verses from the Old Testament, and we'll jump into the New Testament. But this is from the Old Testament. And this is what justice is. We're going to paint a picture here. The scripture is going to paint a picture. Zechariah chapter 7, verses 9 through 10. This is what the Lord of Heaven's army says. Judge fairly and show mercy and kindness to one another. Do not oppress widows, orphans, the resident alien. That's not talking about ET. This means foreigners. Resident aliens, those are living among us who are from another place. Okay, that's... And the poor. He's telling us how to treat those kind of folks. Look at this, Isaiah 58, verses 6 through 9. This is awesome. This, the title, the caption of this is, your prayers won't get you off the ground. Look at this. And this, the context of this is simply God's people saying, what gives? We're praying, we're fasting, and you're not hearing us? And what's up with that? And Jesus says, God says, you want me to tell you what's up with that? Look, he says, this is the kind of fast day that I'm after. He said, what I want you to do is to break the chains of injustice. I want you to get rid of exploitation in the workplace. Free the oppressed. Cancel debts. What I'm interested in, God says, what I'm interested in seeing you do is sharing your food with the hungry, inviting the homeless poor into your homes, and putting clothes on the shivering, ill-clad. Then the lights will turn on, and your lives will turn around at once. Your righteousness will pave your way. The God of glory will secure your passage. And then when you pray, God will answer. You'll call out for help, and I'll say, here I am. We're wondering what's wrong with our nation. We're praying for our nation. Why is it so jacked up? Because, well, we're not doing what it is that God is telling us to do. If we were all doing this, we would radically transform this nation. Too many people are looking to politicians and lawmakers to answer the problem of a divided nation, when really, the real answer to the problem are hearts and minds that are transformed by the gospel, by the love of Jesus Christ, who showed us what it looks like to live a life of justice and mercy and truth. I'm going to give you a few quick examples. Some of you will be familiar with this, but there's a story of the Samaritan woman. This is in John chapter 4, where, first of all, you need to know something about Samaritans. Back in the day, they were seen as racially inferior to the Jewish people. They saw them as reprobates. But it was a racial issue. And for centuries, there was a battle between them. And Jewish people would do everything to avoid them. But what did Christ do? He sought her. And being a woman, it was made even worse, because women were disregarded in that culture and in that time. So she was a Samaritan and she was a woman. Wow. And yet Jesus, he intentionally sought her out, and he had a conversation with her about God and worship and her life and what she wasn't exactly doing correctly. And that conversation led to that woman's salvation, and not only her salvation, but the salvation of many others. So Jesus, he crossed racial divides in order to demonstrate love to someone. All right, we see that when a person back in the day was afflicted with leprosy, which was a disease that made people untouchable, they were seen as unclean. Nobody would even come near them for fear of they themselves becoming afflicted with that disease. And yet, look at how Jesus reached out to this person. This is in Matthew chapter 8, verses 2 and 3. It says, Jesus came down the mountain with the cheers of the crowd still ringing in his ears. Well, then a leper appeared and went to his knees before Jesus, praying, Master, if you want to, you can heal my body. Well, Jesus reached out and he touched him, saying, I want to be clean. Then and there, all signs of the leprosy were gone. He demonstrated this humanizing kindness. This person who was untouchable, Jesus laid hands on him and healed him. It's a beautiful scene. And then, lastly here, listen to how Jesus responds to a poor blind beggar named Bartimaeus. Now, I want you to imagine the scene as being played out in Portland. Imagine it's one of the people who we can sometimes look down at with disgust and frustration, seeing them as perfectly capable of working, all of those things that come to my mind, or and your mind, if you're honest. Listen and imagine that is the person that he's talking to. This is Mark chapter 10, verses 46 through 52. When Jesus and his disciples had passed through Jericho, a large crowd joined them. Upon leaving the village, they met a blind beggar sitting on the side of the road named Bartimaeus. When he heard that Jesus was passing by, he began to shout, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me now in my affliction. Heal me. Those in the crowd were indignant, and they scolded him for making such a disturbance. But he kept shouting with all his might, Son of David, have mercy on me now and heal me. What did Jesus do? He didn't ignore him like everybody else was trying to do, silencing him, telling him to shut it. Jesus stopped and said, tell him to come to me. And so they went to the blind man and they said, have courage, get up, Jesus is calling for you. And so he threw off his beggar's cloak, jumped up, and made his way to Jesus. And Jesus said to him, okay, so what do you want from me? Well, the man replied, my master, please, I want to see again. Jesus responded, your faith heals you. Go in peace with your sight restored. And at once the man's eyes opened and he could see again, and he began at once to follow Jesus, walking down the road with him. So three examples where Jesus showed love and compassion to the outcast, to the poor, to the sick, and to the one who was seen as racially inferior. Jesus routinely hung out with people who were deemed as outcasts, social outcasts, misfits. I'm going to show you a photo that has been criticized by a number of Christians, which is probably why I like it so much. But I also like it because I believe it's a very true depiction of something that I'm going to read to you here in a moment. Okay, so I'm going to give you some context to understand what it is, what portion of Scripture inspired it before I show you, okay? This is Mark chapter 2, verses 15 through 16. Kids, you're doing great. I'm almost done. All right. Jesus and his disciples were at home having supper with a collection of disreputable guests. Unlikely as it seems, more than a few of them had become followers. The religious scholars and Pharisees saw him keeping this kind of company, and they lit into his disciples, saying, what kind of example is this, acting cozy with this riffraff? Well, Jesus, overhearing them, shot back, who needs a doctor, the healthy or the sick? I'm here inviting the sin sick, not the spiritually fit. I recognize that the context of this scripture is talking about people who are sinners, but in light of what I just read to you, the ones who were seen as riffraff was the Samaritan woman, was the leper, was blind Bartimaeus. That's why they told him to shut it, get out of here. They were disgusted with them. Jesus hung out with all sorts, tax collectors, disreputable sinners. He loved them, all folks. So with that in mind, I want you to look at this photo. This is the one that caught some heat. See, it's a depiction. This is not the Last Supper. This is the scene in this artist's mind of Jesus hanging with those disreputable sinners. I'm going to tell you what. Some of my homeboys looked like the dude on the top right corner back in the day. And what were people up in arms about? Yeah, well, look, they have beer on the table. Actually, if you look close, not that it matters. They're wine coolers. Well, what do you think Jesus was drinking with them? Dumb. He was drinking wine. Oh, well, it wasn't the same wine as... Save it. That is so lame, and it's a lie, and I'm telling you it's a lie. I'm not going to get into that. That's for another message. But they're all up in arms about that. So I would ask you, how do you feel when you see that? This is what that would seem to look like in 2019. Jesus hanging around with dudes who look like thugs. Somebody was like, "Well, yeah, but is that a transgender on the top right? Who cares?" Oh, well, people get mad. Well, that's, you know, I'm just saying, really, who cares? Well, what are you saying, Rudy? I'm just saying that Jesus loves everyone. And while some people get all up in arms about that, man, I thank God that he hangs around with people like that, because I was riffraff. Sometimes I still is the riffraff, quiet as it's kept. You know what I mean? We should thank God that he is one who doesn't judge by outward appearances. Peter says this, Acts chapter 10, verses 34 and 35. It won't be up here on the screen, but I want to read it to you, because he says, "Now I know for certain," this is after having a vision, because there was this hatred, even, not hatred, but a disregard for Gentiles. The Jewish people didn't want to hang out with them, okay. But Peter caught a vision, and what he said was, "Now I know for certain that God doesn't show favoritism with people, but he treats everyone on the same basis. It makes no difference what race of people one belongs to." And I love that. And especially in light of our congregation here, man, we got Mexican. If you got a Mexican who is the pastor of the place, right? But we got black folk, white folks, Pacific Islanders, Asian, and everything in between. It's awesome. Filipinos. We have a wonderful body of believers here. It's really awesome. But this is more than just about race. What I'm talking about is how God loves everyone regardless of how they might look on the outside, or whatever political affiliation. Again, the Lord doesn't see things the way that you and I see, 1 Samuel 16, verse 7. People judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. And if we want to be like our Father in heaven, if we want to walk in the steps of Jesus, well, then we need to stop looking at people from outward appearances too. Now, I'm going to make a quick point here, because I think it gets back to Beauty and the Beast, all right? There's a parable that Jesus tells some folks about a banquet that's going to happen at the end of time. There's going to be a huge banquet. And Jesus makes a point about this banquet because he's at a banquet with people, and he's saying, man, all you do is invite the rich people, people who can pay you back. The kind of banquet that I want you to throw, in fact, the banquet that I'm going to be throwing, let me tell you about it. And so he goes on to say this. "Quickly, get out into the city streets and alleys. Collect all who look like they need a square meal, all the misfits," any misfits in the house? Yeah. "And all the homeless and the wretched," or so-called wretched, "that you can lay your hands on, and bring them here." And I like that because it reminded me of the little song in Beauty and the Beast, like, be our guest, that is all that I know. I don't know the song. Okay, but I looked it up, and I was looking at some of the lyrics. And let me just read you just a couple of lines that I found most poignant, particularly in light of the subject matter here. So, be our guest, put our service to the test. Okay. "Life is so unnerving for a servant who's not serving. He's not whole without a soul to wait upon." Jesus told us to love one another. Love as I have loved you. And he demonstrated how we are to do that. It's to serve one another in love. And it's not just serving the people who look like us, or who talk like us, or who have the same kind of bank account that we have. No. He said, I already read it to you, the widow, the orphan, the resident alien. And one day, he's going to put our service to the test. At the end, he's going to say, how did you treat those in prison, those without clothes on their back, those who were hungry, those who were sick, those who are oppressed, racially or economically, whatever. All of that is, yeah, put our service to the test. He will. It's our call to serve upon those souls who are labeled as outcasts, disreputable sinners, refuse, whatever it may be. That is what we are called to do. And so, be our guest, yeah. What I want our church family here to do is to welcome. We could sing that same song, inviting all to come in, going out to the streets of Forest Grove or Banks or wherever it is you're from, Cornelius or Gaston. Be our guest. Come on in. We're going to demonstrate for you the love of Christ no matter what you look like, what persuasion you are, what gender, any of that doesn't matter. That's, oh man, so badly. I want that. God wants that, most importantly. But God, Christ wants that. I want that. My staff wants that. Our leaders, that's what we want. To be a church that doesn't just talk about being an inviting, safe place. No, but truly to be that for people. The entire ministry of Jesus was to destroy walls of hostility, bringing people close who were once pushed away. He removed the dividing wall of hostility that was between us, his Father, and his creation, as well as the wall of hostility that existed between those who were in and those who were out. The walls torn down. Jesus did all the work necessary. It was the unconditional love of Bel that rescued a beast, and so it is the unconditional love of God that removes that beast in us, the bigotry, the racism, the judging people by outward appearances, is healed in us by recognizing the grace and the love that's been extended to us in spite of our outward appearances. This ministry of reconciliation is one that needs to continue through the work of Old Town Church and the people represented here who are part of this family, and I hope we'll do that for as long as God sees fit for this church to stand, right? That's all I have to say about that, I think, right? All right, thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah.